So good morning to all of you. You know, we will start our discussion. Okay. So voice is audible, no?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So anyway, so this is you followed, right? So you know. So now I see. So last class, I know we have closed our you know, these bolted connections. Essentially, simple only. Okay. So we'll come back to this bolted connections, you know, for when we design movement, resisting and beam column and others at a later stage. Okay. So now we have started this welded connections also. So as already you see, we defined in our last class. So welding means, you know, so we join this metal pieces, say that is a base metal and the weld metal and maybe another, you know, the base metal itself by heating them, you know, that to a point where you see they become melted and then, you know, they will mix with each other and then they form a continuous piece. So this is what you see we define as a welding, you know, the connection and the rod which is used, say, okay, that is weld metal. So that is what we are calling as this is a welding rod. And to generate heat, sometimes people use electricity or that gas, okay, that is acetylene torch, they say. So now, you know, another most important thing was whenever you have to do welding, say, the weld metal, you should use a coated rod, okay? So it is not like ordinary welding rod because, you know, when you are doing welding, say, the things are getting melted. So oxygen in the air, you know, so some impurities, if they are there, sulfur or something, so you may get some type of oxides, which, you know, will create voids or some problem, you know, slag and other things in the weld. So generally people use these coated rods basically so that, you know, some gas comes out and oxygen, you know, there will be no issues like this. So this is what they call as a shielded arc basically. So shielded arc means, you know, you are shielding the, you know, the weld metal without, you see, that oxygen oxides, you know, not getting formed kind of thing itself. So and anyway, the welding is a very, very complicated and, you know, the metallurgy or the welding procedure and the skill also, you know, is a very, very important. The person who is doing welding and many of the projects, if you see, most of the failures are, you know, because of this skill only. The welding has not been done properly itself. So this also I showed you, this is our oxyacetylene torch, how does it look like, you would have seen in many shops itself, and this is our electrode. So you will have a, you know, this is a weld metal, these type of coated things will be there. So where when it melts, you know, some gas gets formed, inert gas, so your weld, this one, so it will be safe from, you know, this oxides and oxygen and other kind of thing itself. Now, you know, there are four methods are widely used in welding. So this shielded metal arc welding, say, so this is the first one, which is the one which is widely used in outside many shops, you know, during the, or when steel structures are getting constructed, say, so they do at the field itself. So that we call as SMEAW, shielded metal arc welding. Gas metal arc welding, you will see it in many shops, that gas, you know, the oxyacetylene torch or something. Now the another, this is submerged arc welding, say, this is the one which is done in the factories. So there are factories, you know, which are automatically robotics you follow. They do this type of, you know, submerged arc welding, and that is the most efficient. Okay, but of course it is you know, expensive also. Upon the, of course, from that there are some other, you know, the method techniques are there. So now in our India, say, as we have IIT, right, Indian Institute of Technology, we have Indian Institute of Welding also, IIW. So this is also institute is there in Calcutta, you know, so they also give, you know, certificates, they train people how to do welding, and there are ITIs, many things are there where they teach how to do welding, you know, this and they give certificate also, so for this welding itself. So anyway, so now when coming to this, these are the electrodes I showed you, the welding rod. So each welding rod will have a coating on the top. Okay, so this coating, when it burns, you know, it generates some gas and then it stops this oxidation and other issues itself. Now, one of the most important thing what you should observe is the weld metal, say, basically its yield stress will be higher than, you know, the yield stress of the parent metal, that is our mild steel. Why? What is the reason? So why we choose weld metal to be at a, you know, very high strength compared to the parent metal?
So that the weld does not fail before the member.
No, before the member itself. Very good. Okay. So that is why the thing we choose. Okay. Now these are the joints, fillets, fully penetrated welds, you know, partially penetrated butt welding, plug welding, slot welding. I showed you in the last class. So this is how the plug welding they do. So they drill a hole and then, you know, they pour the weld metal itself. And this is a plug welding, this slot welding, say. So here also same as a plug only, instead of circle, they may drill, you know, something like this, okay? Some, and then they pour the weld metal, or they may weld, you know, these are these edges or something like that to give, make a connection kind of a thing. So they do like this also sometimes, okay? So this is a plug, you know, the welding itself. So then, so this is a fillet weld, you can see how, you know, this welding, this portion, say. So this is what they call as a fillet weld. And this is, you know, the butt welding kind of a thing, you can see. And the excess weld, say, this generally is known as reinforcement. In concrete, reinforcement means steels. In welding means excess weld, say, we call as a reinforcement. And now, you know, so fillet weld, say, this is a very famous, this one, the fillet weld, routinely used basically, okay? So if you want to connect like a T-joint, say, so this you use a fillet weld, a lap joint you can do, then corner joints also, you know, this fillet welding can be done. Of course, fillet welding can be done on other side also, but, you know, it depends. So now if you want to connect a pipe to a plate joint, say, see, you can do nice fillet welding, you know, on the outside. Then, you know, cap, bevel, weld, so many, you know, variety ways are there for this fillet weld. And one more important thing also all of you should understand is in welding, you know, generally the words they use, single run weld basically, multi run also. They say that, you know, our IS code also in single run, this much should be the weld thickness. Single run means, you know, when you are doing welding at a single point of a time, you are dropping all the metal itself in one go. So that is what we call a single run. Now, multi-run means, you know, you deposit this metal, say, then after some time you deposit like this, after you deposit like this, you know, so this they call as, you see, multi-run also. So this is a welding terminology. So they say single run, multi-run, you know, single run means one go, multi-run means, you know, you do several kinds of things. So each of them has their own advantage and other things, but this is in welding terminology, they use these type of words, single run, second run. First run means first he would have deposited, second run means, you know, second time how much he is depositing the weld metal. So these are terminology they use. And now coming to, before going to design of this welding, say, now as already I told you, welding is basically, you know, metallurgy, mechanical subject. It's not a completely, you know, a civil engineering kind of a thing, but we will do the design. No, how to do the design of these welds only we are going to discuss here. So to do the designs, first you should know what type of defects, you know, in the weld, you see, happens basically. Like we have seen in the plates also, like the bolted connections, we have seen shear failure, bearing failure, all kinds of things. Then our design was, you know, the formulas or whatever has come in the IS code, say, they are all based on those type of defects, how to avoid those failures. So based on that only, we derive, you see, all the design formulas itself. Now, when it comes to welding, say, for design for welding also, you should know the defects or the what are the failures in welding. Now, one most important thing you should remember is, compared to bolted connections, say, welding is a very, very complex, say, you know. And then identification of defects, say, it's extremely difficult, you know, by looking at the weld. You know, some defects maybe you can identify, but what is happening inside the weld, say, see, like for example, you know, we have this, say, so inside this welding, so somewhere here, say, what type of defects exist, whether there are any cracks are there or not, you know, you can't do visual, you know, the inspection. Bolts means, you know, you can have a visual inspection, basically you can see where that nut has been not been tightened properly, or, you know, the washer has broken. So visual inspections, you know, they work nicely for bolts. And then, but in welding, what happens is, once the welder has done the welding, say, so you don't know, see, like for example, this is a welding, say, here there may be a defect, or here there may be a cracks also, they may get formed. So you can't see all these things, and if you want to see, you can't, you have to break the weld, but you can't break the weld, you know, in an existing structure. So, you know, observing the weld defects itself is very, very difficult. So there are non-destructive techniques are there, like ultrasound, you know, magnetic, some particle. So non-destructive techniques are there. So without, you know, destroy, you know, without doing anything to the existing weld, so you do like ultrasound, okay? Like how they do, you know, inside our body also. So they do ultrasound and then they try to identify whether there are any cracks or what type of failures have been done. So these methods are magnetic, some methods are there. So where they examine these defects. So compared to bolted connections, welding things are, you know, extremely complex for inspection. So inspection itself is very, very difficult. Because visual inspection, you know, you can't do outside, everything may look fine, but inside there may be a crack. which we cannot identify, okay, without opening the weld. So, and you can't open also. So, we use these type of non-destructive techniques to identify all these problems itself. So, there are many weld defects are there, not only 5, 6, 7, so many, you know, defects are there in weld, but these are the most things which are widely observed in practice. One is, you see, this incomplete fusion or, you know, the penetration kind of a thing. Then we have porosity. This is also main thing. So, where voids or gas pockets, say, they trap in the weld. Then slag inclusion. This happens if any of the molten metals comes in contact with oxygen, you know, some oxides gets formed, and then, you know, they may be trapped inside the welding itself. Then cracks is a huge problem in welding, internal cracks. So you can have variety of you know, the cracks, longitudinal, micro cracks, you know, this crack, you know, long transverse line, and you know, so many things will be there. Then we have undercutting also, okay. So this also, you know, if you have not cut the base metal sometimes, you know, so this also comes into picture. So I will just show you. So like you see, this, you can see the lack of incomplete fusion, you can see here. So this place is a, so the weld metal, the welder, you know, he has not deposited properly the weld metal. So the parent metal is here. So you have a gap here, you can see here. Okay. So this is what they say as incomplete, you know, fusion. So here it has not happened, you know, the properly. Sometimes incomplete penetration will be there. So you can see the weld metal has, it has to fill everything. But this small place, say, this, you know, at the root or whatever, you know, that it has not been deposited properly. So incomplete penetration, we say. Then, so here also you can see. So here, you know, there is no penetration has not happened. Here also at the root, say, some small, you know, the weld metal has not gone exactly to that point. So lack of fusion. So, you know, so this is the one thing. Then gas pocket. This is a very, very, you know, the important thing. Because, you know, some gas, because it is getting melted, right? And after that, it cools and makes as a solid. So some gas may get, you know, pocket, maybe there are some kind of a voids inside the welding. So this also may happen. Then slag inclusion. Slag is anyway, you know, like oxygen, you know, will be there. And, you know, this weld molten metal comes into contact, say, with oxygen, the impurities will be there. So you will see this type of, you know, the slag or some oxide formation inside our, you know, the weld itself. Then undercut, you can see here clearly this figure shows. So sometimes what happens is, you know, we will because he will be using that, you know, that electric arc or the heat, so the parent metal, say, it gets cut here because of that, you know, the arc itself. So this is what they call as undercut. Then there is a overlap also. So like this, you know, so many you followed, right, the things are. And then of course we have cracks also. Cracks may form in the parent metal, okay, or in the weld metal also. Some types of cracks also, you know, will be formed itself. And we have another thing which they call as a spatter. I don't know how many of you have seen, if you do welding, how they do in the field, say, that, you know, electric things will be, you know, coming out actually. And even the weld metal, say, it has to get deposited here. But because of the welding, if it is not doing properly, so the weld metal, you know, small pieces, they may get deposited on the plate outside. Not only the weld metal, even the parent metal also, because it has been melted, say. So sometimes they get deposited outside the area also. So this they call as, you see, spatter. So like this, you know, so many defects are there. So you can see, so this is, you know, what do you call this defect? So you can see here small pieces. Now what are those? You can see how he has, you know, done the welding. See, outside also small pieces got deposited. So this is nothing but spatter. So this is how it looks. So it is a very bad, you know, the welding. So that welder has not done, you know, his job, you see, properly. Then this is what we call as, you see, porosity. Okay, the gas pockets or something are there, say. So after the metal has cooled, right, the weld. So you will see these type of, you know, these kind of problems itself. So porosity or the gas pockets, say. So like this, you know, the welding, you know, looks like. Then, you know, so you can see this is undercut here. So you can see here in this figure, what has happened, this portion, say, what has happened. Welding is perfectly fine. This is a parent metal was like this, okay. So the parent metal, what happened was, you know, because of the electric arc or something, he has cut the, you know, the parent metal itself. So this is what we call as, you see, undercut here. So you can see, so undercut here. Or, you know, sometimes, you know, that the root also, say, there will be a cutting like this, or in, even inside also, the welding has to be very smooth like this. But, you know, here there is a cut like this. So these are all, you know, happens. Now the gas porosity you can see. So this is one plate, this is another plate. Here you can see this type of, you know, the gas voids. Okay, so how they look like. Then wormholes are there, then, you know, surface porosity also near the surface. So many, you know, issues are there. And these things you cannot observe in a, you know, a visual inspection. You may have to do ultrasound or, you know, the non-destructive techniques to take, you know, to scan this, the welds. Then only you can see all these type of defects also. Like, yes, and another most important thing is welding overlap. Too much of welding, basically. So instead of, you know, dropping little bit of weld metals, he has dropped so much weld metals. So this also gives rise to, you know, lot of, you know, other problems itself. So this also is this issue. Then, you know, so we can have slag inclusion, they say. Okay, so that is that oxides and impurities, you know, which they get formed. So you can see this is a multi-run weld. So he has done welding, like in the first run he has dropped this much of weld, then the second run, in the second run, and this is the third run, say. Then you see, you can see here this slag has get formed here, you know, when they are doing this multi-run welding. So this also problem comes. So when you look at in a ultrasound or some non-destructive, you can see these type of, you know, dot 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 kind of a thing in the you know, that images also. And here also you can see some small, you know, these black things, say, in ultrasound image or X-ray kind of a thing, you can see all these defects. And the lack of sidewall fusion, you can see here. So this weld, say, it has not stick to the sidewall here, that is to the main plate. And the lack of inter-run fusion also. See, one run is here. So this is the first run, he has deposited this much amount of weld. Now after depositing, say, then after that, once again, one more run he has done. So this is the second run, say, he has deposited this metal here. So one run to second run itself, you have a gap here. You followed. So that has not been, you know, properly, it has not been done. Then here also, so at the root level, it has not been fused properly. Then, you know, small you followed. This is a multi-run weld, this is, because, you know, he has done so many times. So one weld run, small drop he has put, then, you know, like that he has done. So you can see these type of gaps also. So this is also several things. Incomplete penetration, they say. You can see some small, you know, gap is there. That is, the opening is there. You know, here the weld metal has not passed inside, you know, it has not penetrated completely itself. So here also you can see these type of images, you know. So this one also. And here all this image is very, very clear. He has not done the proper welding actually. Okay. So here also there is incomplete kind of a thing. Root penetration, say. So these are all images, okay, non-destructive technique. They have taken images, and then, you know, you can see all these effects itself. So there are, apart from these things, so many things are there. Like, you know, if you do a welding course, say, you will learn all these details, you know, shrinkage, cavity, misalignment also. Sometimes, you know, this is a parent metal. Because welding, you know, when you do welding, it will be very hot. But once it has cooled, say, so this weld, what happens is it contracts. So then, you know, you will see these type of misalignment actually. Okay, initially you would have thought everything straight, but you know, because of this heating and cooling, say, you will see some other different shape also. So incomplete groove, then his excessive penetration. This is, you can see, yeah, how much he has deposited, too much of weld here. Bottom also, you see, too much of welding has been done. So this also creates a lot of problem. So burn through. Then you stay arc, you see uneven weld bead, so many, you know, the concavity, so many things are there, which, you know, we can do a full course on welding itself. So now this is also one more important thing in our structure, that is lamellar tearing, they say. So this is a technical, you know, the word. And a lot of failures, say, has been attributed to this lamellar tearing in ocean structures, even in civil structures also. See, what happens is, if I'm joining two points, and if I deposit huge metal actually, okay, huge weld metal, say, huge welding has been deposited here on this side and this side. So what happens is, you will see these type of cracks itself actually. So these type of cracks, you know, we call them as lamellar tear. So here also, a huge weld has been dropped here between this and this one. So below this metal, say, you will see these type of cracks. Here also you can see the huge welding metal has been deposited. Below itself you will see a crack. So these type of cracks, you know, we call them as, you see, the lamellar tearing. Why these cracks comes is because when you're dropping the weld metal, say, so this portion will be very, very hot, okay? So when, you know, after you drop this huge weld metal, what happens is it tries to cool. So when it cools, say, the weld metal, it tries to shrink actually. So there will be shrinkage, you know, the strains or something will be there. And then what happens is, because the weld metal shrinks, say, So the below the portion, you know, so this region basically, that is before, between the crack and the weld metal, so this portion, it will have huge, you know, the stress concentrations. See, because the weld metal is, you know, the contracting, the shrinkage is there, you know, the stress concentrations will be there. And if I have I section like this, say, say something like this, okay. So if I have I section or steel plate or whatever, let us say on the top I have done welding to some other things, say. So now here the huge weld has been deposited, say. So then what happens is, once this shrinkage strains will be there, so in the flange, say, you will be having some type of, you know, this type of stresses will come into picture. So this is strain, say, from going to flange to this flange, basically it is not possible, you know, the it cannot transfer these thermal stresses properly. So what happens is, you know, so this portion, huge stress concentration comes, and then these type of cracks you will observe. So this they call as, you say, lamellar tearing itself. So here also you can see this kind of huge, you know, the weld metal has been dropped here exactly below this huge one. So you will see this type of lamellar tearing itself. So you can also see here below the weld metal itself. And this region will be very high stress concentrations because of shrinkage, you know, the weld metal while cooling, say, all these problems will be there. So generally in practice, you know, it's very difficult. So what they do is, you know, the detailing they do, like, you know, instead of doing this one, you know, they say, suggest that you do this way. So don't drop huge this one. So you cut here, say, then, you know, there is a better chance of, you know, the there is a very little chance of, you see, this lamellar tearing. So this like that they do. If I have a connection like this, say, so you do like this, you know, such that to avoid this lamellar tearing. So this also how the lamellar tearing looks like. You can't see in a visual, but if you take some ultrasound or something, so you can see. So this you can see here. So this is a, you know, the lamellar tearing. So you can see this type of a brittle, you know, the failures below the weld metal. So like this, you know, you will observe in the practice also. And this lamellar tearing is a very, very, you followed, very many failures have been attributed this type of lamellar tearing. I think many offshore platforms, you know, you can Google it also. So attributed to these failures. And then there will be in welding, say, residual stresses also will be there. Okay, because, you know, when you do the welding, say, what happens is you are heating. So this whole zone will get heated. But this zone will not be heated. The whole parent metal will not be heated. Only at the junction you will be heating, basically. So it, and the cooling, you know, so it will be non-uniform. So this side of the plate will be subjected to some temperature. Here it will be some other temperature. And once it is heated, say, then it cools, basically. So once it cools, because of tension, compression, the weld is getting shrinked or something. So this will be the stress distribution. So inside this weld metal, say, some tensile things will be there. And, you know, outside is some compressive, so there it will, obviously it will be having these residual stresses also because of, you know, unequal cooling and unequal heating, non-uniform heating. So this problem comes in welding also. So these are the welding defects, and then these residual stresses and all kinds of problems are there in welding itself. So this also is one issue you can see here. So this has been connected to here, say, the connection was this T joint. It was supposed to be like this. But, you know, because, you know, the welding after cooling, say, contraction or something, so instead of like this, so the things have become like this also. So this type of angular distortions, you know, you will feel longitudinal distortion also. See, the welding has been done here, the pipe, but then, you know, you will see this type of shrinkage and other things, you know, you will see all these kinds of distortions also. Here also, you know, you can see they observe this type of distortions. Now you can see I section, say. So he has made I section by joining three flats. He has done only welding one side. So after cooling, you know, the I section, it is not looking like I section. It has become, you know, some other distorted shape. So generally, you know, if you do both the sides, say, then maybe, you know, you may get a perfect this itself. So like this in welding, say, there are a lot of issues and, you know, a lot of problems are there. So anyway, that is defects in the welding. But for design, you know, what we do is, you know, we make these assumptions. If you want to do all those things, it becomes a complicated design. So what our code also, it says is, you know, although of course there are problems are there, so we assume our assumptions. Otherwise, you know, we can't do the design. So what we do is, you know, the welding, say, all the welding is a complicated process, and it may be non-linear or, you know, whatever other issues are there. But we assume that the welds which are connecting the various parts, they are homogeneous, isotropic, and then elastic. So these assumptions we do, okay? Like in our simple bending theory, say, plane sections remain plane, but in reality, you know, it may not be plane, but that is our assumption. then the parts connected by the weld, say, we assume that they are rigid and their deformations we neglect basically, okay? So this also is another assumption. And then only stresses due to external loads only are considered in our design, that is in our IS code, the formula. The residual stresses, as already I told you, welding will have residual stresses. Before applying the load itself, the whole that weld regions, the weld zone, that itself is under, some type of a stresses before applying the load, thermal stresses kind of a thing, it is there. But that also, we reject actually. We don't consider while our design, okay? The stresses, stress concentrations also, shape of the welds also, what type of shape the weld is, whether he has deposited like this or whether he has deposited like this, or a perfect rectangle or whatever. So that is not, important, you see, in the design. So these are the main three assumptions based on which, you see, all the codal formulas have been given. Okay, but we will use a factor of safety, so okay, to avoid all other kinds of issues. So now when it comes to the fillet weld, say, so first we will see a design of this fillet weld. So this is the terminology we use in fillet welding. Okay, so this is my parent metal and this is also another metal, so I want to join them. So I have put this fillet weld. So fillet, as already I told you, the word comes from fillet. Okay, this is an English word. So you merge, say, it became a fillet weld itself. Okay. So now so this is our thing. So this is our weld metal. Okay. So this portion, say, we call as this portion as well as this portion, say, we call as the leg basically. They are the weld size. So leg of the weld, and it is denoted by S. This symbol is used in welding. So wherever S comes, say, so just you should understand that it is the size of the weld or the leg basically. So leg is anyway one side, the both the sides, how much this length of the weld basically. So this not length of the weld, leg of the weld, weld size. Then this one, now this portion, so we call this as a toe, okay, like our foot, say, toe kind of a thing. So this portion, say, is known as root basically. And this also, it will be having two toes, one toe here, another toe this side, and one root will be there. And then if I draw a perpendicular line from the root, say, to this weld, so this portion basically, okay, this quantity, so this portion we call as, you see, the throat thickness or the throat, or throat thickness also, many we know in the code also we write like this, a throat. So throat is nothing but from the root, to say, the perpendicular distance to your weld face basically, that we call as, you see, the throat thickness. So size is different, throat is different, root is here, toe is here. So these words you should know: root of the weld, toe of the weld, then weld size, weld size or leg, okay, or leg also you call them as. Then throat thickness. So these are our design variables basically. And suppose if actual throat is, theoretical throat is here, say, okay, so these are theoretical throat and is actual throat. So theoretical throat means which comes from the codal, the provisions. So code says is this is amount of the throat which you have to provide, and you have provided extra throat, say, extra thing, that we call as the reinforcement. That is extra weld. So if let us say codal provision says 5 mm, you have provided 6 mm, say, so that is a reinforcement kind of a thing, you see, we say. So these are the technical terms. So now in our design variables for fillet weld, say, you should be able to identify the leg, that is a S, that is a leg of the weld, throat thickness basically. So these are the design variables. And another thing also is basically the angle between these two. See, like right now, these two plates, they say, they are perfectly rectangular to the each other or whatever here. So that also depends basically what type of the fusion these faces also, what is the angle also. So yes, that is the leg size, throat thickness. These are our design variables in the welding, in the fillet weld. So code says like this. So the minimum size of the weld. So size means leg. Okay, that is the size of the weld. IS code gives, that is this portion only. Oh, this is what we call as leg. It doesn't give you the throat thickness. Okay. So the minimum size of the weld, say. So the minimum size of the weld, basically the code says it is based on the plate thicknesses. So what is the thickness of the plate? How if you are joining two plates, say what is the thickness of the first plate and thickness of second plate, whichever is thin, you know, so that you have to consider in the design. But our code clearly says is that it should not be less than, you say, 3 mm. So whatever may be the thickness of the plates, say the minimum weld size should be 3 mm. So that is a minimum requirement. So the minimum size of the first run, they say, you can see here, first run means he is doing one go, he is depositing the weld metal. So this is what is given in this table in the IS code. So IS code gives clearly single run the fillet weld. So the thickness is less than or equal to 10 mm, say. So the minimum size is 3 mm. And here, please remember, thickness of the thicker part. Okay, so if you are having two plates, say one thickness is 10 mm, another one is 8 mm or something. Okay, so which one you have to use it in design? So our IS code says the thicker plate, basically, whichever is thick, so that is gives you the minimum size of the weld itself. If the thicker part size is 10 to 20 mm, say, it should be 5 mm, then 20 to 32, say 6 mm, then this much, say, then it will be 8 or first run and 10 for minimum size of the weld. So this is a table given in our IS code. It is already there in IS 800. Okay, and when the minimum size suppose if this is when the minimum size of the fillet weld given in the table is greater than the thickness of the thinner part, so this is based on the thicker part, basically. So now the minimum size of the weld should be equal to the thickness of the thinner part. See, like for example, I have 10 mm plate, then 8 mm is the another plate. So two plates are there. I have to do a lap joint. So one plate is 10 mm, another plate is the 8 mm. So two small you followed it. The plates are there. So now what should be the minimum size? Now, what should be the size of the weld? Two plates, their thicknesses are different. Now, see, what is the thicker plate size?
10 mm.
So now what should be the thickness of the, what should be the size of the weld from the table?
3 mm.
3 mm. But now what is that below here it is given. So when the minimum size of the field is greater than the thickness of the thinner part. So what is the thinner part dimension? Thinner part is?
8 mm.
8 mm. So now how much should be the weld given? See, the minimum size of the fillet weld given in the table. So the table gives you 3 mm. Okay. Is greater than the thickness of the thinner part. A thinner part is 8 mm. So it is not greater, it is lower only. Okay, so what should be the minimum size now?
8 mm.
No, be careful. 8 mm is the plate. See, is a thickness of the thinner part. Thickness of the thinner part is 8 mm. Okay, now the minimum size of the weld which comes from the table is 3 mm. Which is greater? So thickness of the thinner plate only is greater than 3 mm. So when the minimum size of the weld in table is greater than, say, then it should be equal to the thickness of the thinner part. Okay, so see, the read this line carefully. So now what should be the weld size?
3 mm.
3 mm only. Okay, suppose from the table, let us say this is a 2 mm plate, say. Now let us say 10 mm, 2 mm. Now
2 mm.
2 mm should be, that is what you see the code says. Okay, so be careful. So your thickness minimum size depends on the thicker part of the plate. So in bolted connections, many times we take the thinner part only, for calculating the strength of things, whichever is small we used to take. But here you have to be in the IS code, say, you have to read the lines the carefully. These are all the lines are there in the IS code only. Okay, there is nothing to worry. In that connections only you will see this one. And now another thing is, if where the thicker part is more than 50 mm thick, then code doesn't say anything, but preheating, all kinds of things you have to do, because cracks may form. And here also, when the thicker part also should be adequately preheated to prevent cracking of the weld. So they say, all these details. So anyway, for us, the size of the weld is a very, very important. And size means it is not throat thickness. It is a size, that is a leg, one side leg, that is a distance from root to toe. Okay. So this depends on the thicker part you would select. And then, this is one small guideline. So the plate thickness is lower than this minimum size prescribed by the table, you can take to the plate thickness itself. So this is what you see the code also says, you know. So whenever you have, so you should give additional, you know, the reinforcement itself. So this is a theoretical thing. If you provide less than the thing, then, you know, it is not acceptable also. Okay, that is how, you know, the code says. So anyway, so now we're coming to the maximum size of the weld. Minimum is known, that bound is known. Now what is the maximum size of the weld also? So here also code clearly specifies if the thickness of the plates are less than 6 mm basically. If it is less than 6 mm, size is yes basically. Okay, so yes is the, you know, the size of the weld or something, you see it says. But now when the thickness of the plates say, if it is, you know, more than 6 mm basically. So now what the code says, whatever thickness you get, say it should be 1.5 mm has to be subtracted here. The small portion you should leave. That is what you see the code specifies, you know, the clearly itself. Now when you are having rounded edge, say this is for square edge, so this plate is perfectly, you know, this type of a rectangular or, you know, perfect this one. So T minus 1.5 mm should be the maximum size of the weld. Now if it is a rounded edge, say like many angle sections, they are all smooth because the stress concentrations they want to avoid. So this type of sharp things will not be there. So if it is a smooth, say the code says is thickness of the weld should be, say, 3/4 basically. Okay, or you know, this you should leave a gap of, say, 1/4 times thickness, you know, of the section at the toe. So this you have to leave it basically, you know, then the you know, you have to read this one. So this is how, you know, we calculate the maximum size of the weld. One for rectangular, this type of sharp cross sections, and this one. If it is less than 6 mm, say, then thickness will be T itself. If it is not more than 6 mm only, so you have to leave this small portion because, you know, you may have other kind of problems, you see. If more weld, if you deposit, say, then that lamellar tearing or, you know, some other, you know, the problems may come up. So based on that, the code has suggested this maximum size of the weld also. And now to compute the throat thickness, say that is the throat thickness is this angle, okay, so not this distance, that is we have a weld here, so this is my weld, say, so this is a toe, this is a toe, this is root, and this is leg is a SS kind of a thing which we have. So the distance basically, so this thing what we are calling as throat thickness, how much throat thickness you have to provide. So this the code gives a, you know, a special, you see the formula is there. So they give throat thickness is, you know, some K into, you know, S times, you know, the S is nothing but the size of the weld. So size of the weld, that is the leg, which you will get from the previous IS, you know, that table itself. So size of the weld, once you know, say, you can find out throat thickness by multiplying with a factor K, and this K is, you know, depends on the angle between the fusion faces. Suppose if you are from 60 to 90 degrees, like, you know, I have like this. So this parent two plates, basically the angle between them is, you know, lies in between 60 degrees to 90 degrees, say. So this K will be 0.7. Suppose if it is 90 to 100, say 0.65, that means, you know, the one plate is like this, another plate is, you know, like this. So this angle is, you know, obtuse kind of a thing. So then, you know, the 0.55, 0.5, the strength of the weld reduces, so the throat thickness is automatically, you know, it comes down. So this is how it happens. So leg, we are having a size, leg size, this is S. So this comes from the table, minimum and maximum we have seen. Now the throat thickness, say, it depends on, you know, the angle between these faces, that is the two plates itself. So generally, if it is a 90 degrees, say, if you are doing, say, so then this turns out to be, you know, 0.7 times, or that 45 degrees angle basically. So that 0.707 times, you know, you can take this throat thickness. Okay, it is just a 45 degree angle itself. So the, and the extra thing, whatever you are providing, say, so this is sufficient, but whatever extra you provide, so this we call as, you see, the reinforcement in the weld itself. So now this is how, you see, the reduction, same thing only I'm showing here. So you know, these are the reduction factors, same table only, whatever I showed you previously, same table I'm showing. So if the, depending on the angle, so you can see this is my angle, you know, that is angle between the faces, size. So you have 60 to 90 means, you know, 0.7, 45 degrees angle. So this is, you know, right? So if I have a triangle, say, you can easily find out the throat thickness is also based on the AB. So based on this one, they give this type of charts. 120, say, this is a 0.5. So this is given in our IS code. So our IS code, you know, this is a British code basically. So British code also, you know, I think more or less, I think these numbers have been taken from, you know, the old British codes maybe. Okay. So this is the British code, same numbers are there, whatever in our IS code also for the welding. So based on this angle between these two, you know, the parent metals or the parent plates, so you have to decide this K, that is a throat factor. Then we call it, then the length of the weld also, there is a one more design variable. So now the length of the welding cell, the minimum should be more than four times the, you know, the size of the weld, four times, yes. So if leg size is, you know, 3 mm say, like thickness less than 10 mm means, you know, 3 mm. So the length of the weld should be, you see, 4 times, you know, yes, that means 4, 3 is a 12 mm should be the minimum length of the weld you have to provide. Then for calculating effective length, say, which we will do in our design calculations, is basically the actual length of the weld, that is 4S, say. So 4S if you take minus 2 times the weld size. This only we will take to calculate our design strength of the weld. So to have some factor of safety, right? So we are leaving some portion of the length, assuming that, you know, it will not carry any load itself, and then we use that for our to calculate the design, you know, the strength itself. And then when you are doing welding, say, like this one, see, one welding here, one side of the plate you are doing welding, other side of the plate you are doing welding, say. So this is per distance basically. So this distance between these two welds should not be more than 16 times the thickness of the thinner part, that is a thin plate. A thin plate is a 10 mm, say. So 16 times D should not be more than, you know, 160 or something like that. You see, this is also a guideline. Suppose if the distance is more than this much, say, then you have to do another, you know, you may have to drill a hole or whatever. So you have to do this type of plug welding or slot welding, you see, inside also, in between, so that, you know, it will have more buckling and other problems will be there. Because, you know, you are doing welding here and you are doing welding here. And then this is a very, very large, say, and because steel sections are very, very slender, no? So they may buckle, that local buckling may happen between, you know, two weldings also. So what the code specifies is, if it is less than 16 times, no need to do, but if it is more than, then you may have to do this in between also, one type of a plug weld or a slot weld also. So this is also a guideline, you see, which they give. And then they give transverse spacing should not be more than 32 times because of buckling issues. And then if the length, if the effective length, say, if this length is very, very large actually, okay, where when you're having, you know, a very long length, and if it exceeds 150 times throat thickness, say, then you have to reduce the strength also, like, you know, we did for bolted connections also. Like when the long joint means, you know, we have a reduction factor. So here also there is a reduction factor, and the definition of long joint at that time, it was 15 times the diameter of the bolt. Here it is 150 times throat thickness. So throat thickness you find out, you multiply here. If it is more than this, we call it as a long joint. So you have to reduce the size of our, you know, the design strength has to be reduced. So now once you have length, and then you have throat thickness, say, okay. So now the, if you multiply these two, I will get my area, that is effective area of the weld, which will resist the, you know, the load which is coming on the, you know, this area itself. And this is, and in bolted connections, the problem was, if it is in bearing, you had some area. If it is in shear, you have some area. You know, the areas keeps on changing. But in welding, you know, whatever may be the, you know, the force, say, the effective area will be simply length of the weld multiplied by its, you know, the throat thickness. It's a very, very simple in our welding design. Okay. And another thing is, whenever you are doing the welding, what the code says is, here you can see the small portion, say, this is the length of the weld. Actual length of the weld is, you know, L, say. So what code says is, whenever you see any this type of the corners, basically, so you have to do extra welding, that is a two times, you know, yes. So this they call as end returns. Okay, this is also code, the, you know, the word. So this is you basically required to avoid stress concentrations at the corners. Okay, at the corners. And the code specifies, you know, two times of the weld size. So this portion you should do for the welding. And it will not carry any load or something. Just you have to do to avoid this stress concentrations. Okay, so our design variables are leg of the weld. Okay, then throat thickness. So this should know, so not leg of the weld is yes we are using. I'm sorry. Okay, the leg, that is, this is the one design variable. Then we have throat thicknesses. Then we have length of the weld. How much length I have to do the welding, And then, so these are the three design variables only. So if I know these three things, then, my design is almost followed and done itself. So now this is a design stress for a fillet weld. So this formula is there in our IS 800. And because everything is governed by shear, say, so shear means, fu by root 3 kind of a thing you have. So the load carrying capacity, say, will be, this is the area of the welding. So this is the area multiplied by stress will give you, the design, how much, strength this one carry. And these are the safety factors, okay, like 1.25. For shop welding, say, for site welding, it is 1.5, which is given in that, that limit, that is a safety factors. Okay. So this how, we calculate the design strength of the weld. It's very, very simple. Just load means force into area. Area of the weld is, length multiplied by the throat thickness. And then you multiply by this fu by root 3 gamma, mw. So gamma mw anyway is our factor of safety. So now when it is subjected to tensile or shearing forces also, the stress in the weld you can find out, you see, is also straightforward. Force by area will give you obviously, the stress also, okay. And when a weld is subjected to a combination of normal and shear stress, say, okay, normal stress also is there, shear stress also is there, then the equivalent stress, you have to use this criteria, that is three times, Q square, where Q is the shear basically, okay, combination, and this is my normal stress. This comes from where, when, how to do this combination? This comes from which theory? So root 3 comes from which theory, basically?
1 Mises.
So it comes from 1 Mises. This also comes from 1 Mises theory also. You remember that when I showed you. So this was 1 Mises theory is based on, that deviatoric portion of the stress tensor. Okay, so this is my deviatoric port, that I2, that is, you followed, right? Invariant of a deviatoric part. So this is the same expression, say. So this is my, the yield strength in the uniaxial tension test. This is my, the deviatoric part, the second invariant of the stress tensor. Now, when I'm having normal stress, okay, normal stress, let us say sigma 11, and shear stress means sigma 12, all other stresses are zero. So now what happens to this formula? Sigma 11 is no, it is not zero. So this is zero, this is zero, this is zero, then this is zero, but this is not zero, then this is zero, then this is zero. Now what happens? What happens to this expression? Square root of, is it 2 times sigma, 11 square comes, plus 6 times sigma 12 square comes, divided by 2. Now, what happens here? So 2 gets cancelled and this becomes 3. So sigma 11 is normal, sigma 12 is shear. So sigma 11 square plus 3 times, the shear stress. So the same thing comes in our code also. You can see here. So this everything comes from that 1 Mises only. Okay, that same deviatoric portion, so the combination also. So the same combination you should use, that same failure theory has to be same. Whether it is a pure shear or normal plus shear or whatever you do, say, we use that type of thing, ductile, the failure itself. So this should be less than, this is how, you have to calculate. This stress should be less than this one, and you identify your throat dimensions and, the length of the weld using this formula. Now, when you are having, three stresses, say, bearing stress, then bending stress, then shear stress, say. So bearing is also a normal type of stress only. Like, and bending is also normal stress. Shear anyway, we have the shear kind of a thing. So then you should use, this formula. This formula also, how it comes? From the same, this theory itself. That 1 Mises theory. So now, instead of sigma 11, sigma 12, so now you have one more stress, bearing stress. That is also normal stress only. So compression, tension kind of a thing. So now in this formula, say, these three are non-zero. All others are 0-0 kind of a thing. Then obviously, you followed it. You will get from the same formulas, you will get these numbers itself. So 3 times Q square, FB, FBR, all these terms comes from those formulas itself, 1 Mises theory itself. So this is how, we can calculate the all kinds of stresses, stresses are, the load carrying capacity of our fillet welds. So now I think almost we have reached, I think tomorrow's class, or maybe this Friday, or, we will see how to solve, these type of problems, okay. I will stop here. So the next class, we will continue our discussion. So if you have any questions, you can ask me. Stop recording.